Yes.
You wanted to see us, Bishop Stefan?
Reverend Walther, good to see you. I realize that it seems that we have just arrived in New Orleans, but are you ready to see your brother in St. Louis?
It would be great to see him again.
Well, gather up the group because we just received word from Dr. Marbach. We have secured passage for the steamboat Selma. We will be leaving in the morning.
Brother Herman, it's so good to see you!
I cannot believe that we've finally made it. I have so much to share with you.
Well, come inside our office and warm yourself. Dr. Marbach has secured rooms for all of us. We can attend to that later. Are you hungry?
I think that a warm meal besides the steamboat fare would be most welcome.
Where's Bastard Stefan? He should join us.
Well, he told me to go ahead. A serious throat ailment has been keeping him slowed down for a couple of days, so he wants to stay on board the Selma just for a little while longer and then return to his hotel. Ah, it looks like Dr. Marbach is already on his way over there. I think the bishop is in good hands.
Yes. Well, I've heard something about this new bishop arrangement.
Yes, this is the first step towards a new emigrant government. A great idea, I assure you.
Well, let me tell you all about it over this hot lunch that you promised.
Pastor Stefan rather liked St. Louis. Upon arrival, his throat ailment kept him indoors, but he'd set himself up in a rather opulent room. So indoors was not too bad for Pastor Stefan.
Oh, poor Pastor Stefan. We've been in St. Louis for days and his throat is still so sore. I just looked in on him. I'm afraid his sore throat is still keeping him abed. I don't think we'll be seeing him again today.
Pastor Kyle. Ferdinand. So glad you could make it. Yeah, please, come and have a seat. Now, I wanted to meet with you both today to discuss the investiture of bishop upon the good Reverend Stefan. Now, granted, we took this upon ourselves and committed to this on board the Olbers, but we just felt that it was a grand gesture of thanks to Bishop Stefan for all of the great leadership he has bestowed upon us. After all, we are all here in St. Louis due to his vision and leadership.
Well, that's true. Oh, there's my dear niece. It's so good to see you helping out.
Yeah, Pastor Stefan is keeping her busy, and she gets to board here with the other young ladies in return for helping.
May I bring you anything else, Uncle?
No, thank you. This is fine.
Looks like Pastor Stefan needs a lot of help.
Well, yes, he does like nice things. Anyway, it was en route that we felt that this was a fulfillment of dreams and wishes we have cherished for many years, important causes. And we were confident in your complete agreement with us. Now, this is what was agreed upon on the Olbers, and this is the document that was signed by everyone aboard the Selma. And it is our hope that you and your congregations will add your approval to this grand and noble endeavor.
Well, I see no reason not to trust your judgment on this, my brother. Of course, we'll give you our support.
Thank you, Ferdinand. That means a lot to me.
Delivery for Martin Stefan?
You can bring that this way, please.
I'm sure he'll enjoy it. It is our best wine and cheese.
He does indeed like nice things.
Our worship services were held in the basement of Christ Episcopal Church.
The Episcopalians were most gracious in allowing us the use of their church. It was a brand new building, and for them to open their doors to us was most honorable.
But it reminded us that we needed to find a place to call our own, and so Bishop Stefan began scouting for a suitable place for our people to relocate.
As you can see, Bishop, this land is bordered by the Merrimack River, which gives us easy access to the Mississippi. And there are 15,000 acres, plenty of room to grow. And because it contains several sulfur springs, we can even turn it into a health resort. Look at this soil, very rich indeed. Some of the land is heavily wooded, so with fuel bringing high prices in St. Louis, we have an excellent opportunity to realize a handsome cash profit on this investment immediately, helping us to make it financially.
No, this just will not do.
It's too close to the big city. The people will become corrupted by the influence of the metropolis. We must find a place farther out in the wilderness, thus more opportunity for our financial return.
But Bishop, at this attractive price and on these easy terms, how can you not agree that this land is simply irresistible?
I do not. How dare you think to contradict me, Dr. Vasey? Now find me another tract of land. This one will not do. Remember, I am your bishop.
We found several sections of available land in the area of Perry County, approximately 100 miles south of St. Louis.
It is with great pleasure that I announce the purchase of the land for our new colony. We have purchased 4,400 acres in the county of Perry, Missouri. And the first group of immigrants will be leaving this Friday aboard the steamboat United States. I have here a list of those who have been granted passage, along with myself, Dr. Marbach, Mr. Gube, Mr. Nitschke. There are only a limited number of dwellings available for living at this time. So we are taking a number of workmen to ready more housing for the entire group as quickly as possible.
Now, that's much better. Don't you agree, Dr. Marbach?
Well, fast improvement, Bishop.
I need my house up there. So we need to stick to my original plan and build the roads. We need roads. So we can get around and get supplies up into those hills. So I can get my new house built. Of course, once I move and take up residence, you can have my current home, Doctor. Let's get a move on, gentlemen. We need these roads built.
I know my wife wants a permanent shelter more than she wants roads to get to our current home, whatever you would call it.
Seems like planting crops would be a good idea, too.
Silence, gentlemen. Whatever you're discussing, I do know it unnecessary. Now let's move.
For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who sees his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself and goes away and forgets what he was like. And what is that mirror, fellow sinners? It is the mirror of God's law. So hold up that mirror close to your face. What do you see there? A heart that loves, even worships earthly possessions, and weeps when God takes those possessions away from us? That reflection in the mirror is the sin of idolatry. Maybe you see in that mirror a mouth that dishonors the Lord's name through filthy speech or by slandering those around us. That reflection is taking God's name in vain. Maybe you see in the mirror coming to God's house only because it is an honored tradition, or because we have to, or because it looks good to others. That reflection is profaning the holy day. What do you see? Do you see a mouth that speaks against those with authority, those whom God has placed over us? That reflection is not honoring our parents and our leaders. Or do you see someone filled with passionate desire for a person who is not your husband or wife? That sin is adultery. Now that we have all looked into that mirror, what are we going to do about it? Say to ourselves, I'm a poor, miserable sinner. I am covered with the foulness of sin. And walk away? That's what those who are only hearers of the word do. They see their wrongdoings clearly enough, but shrug their shoulders and do nothing. God wants to cleanse your sins, wash them away with the blood of Christ, but how is he going to do that if you do not confess them? Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. That is what David said after he had fallen into the terrible sins of adultery and murder. But friends, David confessed his sins. How can we, the servants of Christ, assure you of forgiveness if you do not confess your sins? Be forgiven. Become whiter than snow.
Come in. Come in. Please, please, be seated.
Oh, Pastor, I have done the most vile things. How could there be any forgiveness for me?
My dear, have you missed the whole point of what I said here today? Did I not explain enough that there is forgiveness for all those who confess? Why, there was forgiveness for David, even when he had fallen into the sins of adultery.
That's the sin that I've been living in again and again. How can there be forgiveness for such terrible sins?
Christ died for your sins. And I now, in the name of Christ, proclaim your forgiveness.
Thank you, Pastor. I feel you should know with whom I've committed adultery.
That is not necessary. That person is responsible for his own repentance and confession.
That's just it. I don't think he ever will. You need to know, Pastor. Everyone needs to know.
I don't know. Will it make you feel better?
I'm afraid you'll find out sooner or later.
Yes, perhaps. Tell me then, with whom have you committed adultery?
Pastor Martin Stefan.
Yes, come in.
Pastor Labor, I just can't stand it any longer. After hearing your sermon today, I felt like you were condemning me.
And you have come to me now to confess your sins?
I knew it. You knew all the time.
You were looking right at me when you use the word adultery twice in your sermon.
Miss Hagel, who put you up to this? I mean, someone must have been telling you and the others to do this, to come to me with these confessions.
I don't know what you're talking about, Pastor.
Then you did this on your own? No one spoke to you and bribed or frightened you into this confession? And you know nothing of anyone else coming to me with the same kind of confession? Miss Hagel, do I remember correctly that your name was connected with the arrest of Pastor Stefan last year in Saxon?
That's it. That's when it began.
When what began?
My affair with Martin. Pastor Stefan.
I see. Well, you came here today to receive forgiveness from me as if from God Himself. So be assured that in the name of Jesus Christ, your sins have been forgiven.
Thank you, Pastor.
Go in peace. Peace. That's something I could use right now. Peace.
That was Sunday. Another woman came forward on Tuesday. A fourth confessed on Friday. I had to tell someone, even without all the details.
I knew you were shaking something loose with that powerful sermon on Sunday, Pastor Labor. But this isn't quite what I had expected.
We can't, with good conscience, reveal the names of the women. They came to me in confidence, and I am pledged to keep their identities secret.
We certainly cannot reveal their names without their knowledge and consent. But we, I suppose you, Pastor Labor, can lay it on their hearts that this matter can bring disaster to our entire immigration. The only way to avoid such a situation or disaster would be to have them testify openly against the bishop. And we have to consider the possibility that this could be a conspiracy against Pastor Stefan's influence over us and scatter our whole group and all of our peoples across this country.
I have thought of that. In fact, that came to me right after the first young woman confessed, and I made it a point thereafter to ask each woman whether they had been coerced